These posters were printed in 1936 to celebrate the 50th anniversary of Coca-Cola. These posters were on board. We relined them, linen-backed them, restored them, and you will see all that today at PosterFix. Hi, I'm Chris, and welcome to another edition of PosterFix Studio. Today, we received this Coca-Cola poster, which is from 1936. It's actually a 50th anniversary Coca-Cola poster. It was formulated in 1886, and this poster was made to celebrate it by showing two women in bathing suits of their respective times and different attitudes in their face. This thing is mounted to board several layers. It was a standee originally, and it's got these bullet holes in it. Why are there bullet holes in it? Or perhaps they're BB holes. Someone was taking target practice. This thing has to be relined. It has to be pulled off the board. Here's another one. He sent me two Coca-Cola posters. This one's got some damage in the upper area, but it doesn't have as many bullet holes in it. So both of these pieces have to be soaked off the board, linen-backed, and restored today at PosterFix. The first thing I'm going to do is take one of these posters and put it in this bath. The Coca-Cola Company is an American corporation founded in 1892 and today engaged primarily in the manufacture and sale of syrup and concentrate for Coca-Cola, a sweetened carbonated beverage that is a cultural institution in the United States and a global symbol of American tastes. We're gonna let this Coke poster soak for a few days before I try to take it off the backing. Meanwhile, the other one will wait here for another day to get done. As this poster soaks in the water, I'm finding that the paper, which is mounted to the back of it, is slowly coming off. Some of it is not really responding to the water, but it's stuck to other paper, which is responding to the water. At any rate, there are several layers here. There's board, and then there's another board. And I have to be gentle as I pull it off so as not to rip the poster that's underneath. These posters were originally intended to be standees, freestanding posters, which is why they're mounted to board and why there are several layers of board and paper on the back. But the water appears to have done its job, and the glues have all reversed. Well, I got all the cardboard off the poster, so now I can do the other poster, and then I can linen back both of them. This one has some significant punch holes in it, which we will restore. Let's reline the second one. Coca-Cola. The drink Coca-Cola was originated in 1886 by an Atlanta pharmacist, John S. Pemberton, at his Pemberton Chemical Company. His bookkeeper, Frank Robinson, chose the name for the drink and wrote it down in the flowing script that became the Coca-Cola trademark. Pemberton originally touted his drink as a tonic for most common ailments, basing it on cocaine from the coca leaf and caffeine-rich extracts of the cola nut. So while poster number two is being soaked in water to loosen up the old backing, poster number one will sit here drying from being successfully removed. Well, what about the cocaine that you hear about being in Coca-Cola? The cocaine was removed from Coca-Cola's formula in about 1903. Pemberton sold his syrup to local soda fountains, and with advertising, the drink became phenomenally successful. The invention of the vending machine didn't hurt, as it brought the drink closer to thirsty buyers. To linen back, I need to stretch the screen. I'm going to prepare what I call an extra large screen for these two posters, and I'm going to mount them alone on the extra large screen, even though I could probably fit more posters on there if I really wanted to. The reason for this is that I want to make sure that I have plenty of space around the posters to allow me to do a lot of restoration. The borders need paper fills, which I will do with paper pulp, and I need room to stretch, to breathe, to relax, and not feel pressured to have to avoid touching other posters while I work on these. I am now mixing the wheat paste, and it's important to get it to the right consistency. This is a finer grade of wheat paste than you see being used for wallpaper. This is made especially for paper restoration. Now that I've got the wheat paste prepared, I take an acid-free sheet of paper. I get it wet, I put wheat paste on it, and smother it with wheat paste and get it all nice and saturated and covered, and mount it to the canvas. I'm getting myself centered and lifting the paper. And now I'm rolling out the paper to push out all the air pockets to make sure the paper lies flat on the canvas. And we are now ready for mounting. When we come back, you will see me linen back these two temperance Coca-Cola posters. So don't go away. We are now back in the shop, and over the next several minutes, you will see me mount these two Coca-Cola posters from 1936, celebrating the 50th anniversary of Coke. I'm going to apply the wheat paste directly to the acid-free paper and lay the posters down on top of it, which requires the posters to absorb. They have to absorb the wheat paste and expand. The evolution of the lady's swimsuit is clearly displayed in this poster. What a difference 50 years can make in modern times. The girl on the left is from 1886, and her swimsuit covers a great deal of her body. In the 19th century, the woman's double suit was common, comprising a gown from shoulder to knees, plus a set of trousers with leggings often going down to the ankles. The girl on the right side of this poster shows you what a girl in 1936 would look like in a modern swimsuit, form-fitting, skin-tight, revealing. In the United States, beauty pageants of women in bathing costumes became popular from the 1880s. The one-piece bathing suit first made its appearance in the early 1900s. Annette Kellerman, who was an Australian swimmer, first made it famous, who attracted further attention to the style when, in 1907, she was arrested on a Boston beach for indecent exposure, showing her arms, legs, and the neck. somewhat similar to men's swimsuits of the time. The arrest prompted a wide public outrage, which added to the acceptance of the style, the mystique of the style. Kellerman marketed these bathing suits, and the style became to be known as the Annette Kellerman. The one-piece swimsuit became accepted swimsuit attire for women in parts of Europe by 1910 and other places, and was the authorized attire for women's swimming at the 1912 Summer Olympics, the first at which women competed. People started caring more about sunbathing than they did about ocean bathing, and the materials used to make swimsuits improved. New things came along. Rayon was used in the late 1920s as the manufacturer of tight-fitting swimsuits, but its durability, especially when wet, proved problematic, with jersey and silk also sometimes being used. By the 1930s, the necklines of women's swimwear plunged at the back, sleeves disappeared, and sides were cut away and tightened. With the development of new clothing materials, especially latex and nylon, through the 1930s, swimsuits gradually became hugging the body with shoulder straps that could be lowered for tanning. And since the 1960s, the bikini two-piece bathing suit has won popular acceptance. However, the one-piece bathing suit still maintains its position as a staple style that's not going away. Where do these posters crop up? The owner of this poster found it being used as insulation in an old house. It's not the first time I've heard of Coke posters being found being used as insulation in old homes from about 100 years ago. If you live in such an old home, you might want to go rip down your walls to see if you have a fortune there, because Coca-Cola posters of this vintage sell for a lot of money. It is interesting to note that this poster sold in 2008 at Morphy Auctions for $2,070. And I can't find any more recent sales records than that. Coca-Cola is a global corporation that not only created an iconic beverage, but also an exemplary brand. More than 1 billion Cokes are consumed every day. This brand is so iconic, collectors clamor for Coca-Cola memorabilia, including antique ads, signs, bottles, posters, and other branded paraphernalia. Coke's popularity has lasted generations, but goes beyond the quality of the product. The company has a way of capturing historical moments and using advertisements to reflect on values, fears, interests, and aspirations of society. As we look back at Coca-Cola ads through the ages, whether you're a collector of Coca-Cola memorabilia or not, when you look back at a Coke advertisement from 1936, stop for a minute to think about who would have seen it and how that would have affected them. Take note of the increasing diversity of gender, race, and age, as well as the evolution of technology and fashion. Both national and international events shaped how people interpreted each advertisement and contributed to Coca-Cola becoming one of the most loved and most collected brands in the world. I believe the artist of this poster is Haddon Sundblom. Anybody out there who knows for sure, let me know. Write it in the comments section. And please, if you're enjoying these Posterfix videos, please like the video and subscribe. Just think of all you will get in a subscription. An almost daily blog of interesting posters being restored at Posterfix. I'm now washing off the posters' faces with a damp sponge to make sure all the wheat paste is off the face and they are nice and clean. Don't go away. We'll be right back. And now let's get back to the shop. This screen has been drying for about a day, 24 hours. I'm going to go in and do some paper fills. I'm using a mixture of paper pulp powder and methyl cellulose to create a paste, which I call paper pulp paste. I have other names for it. I'm using it to fill in the areas where there is paper missing, both on the edges and within the face of the poster. Thank you. This ridge where the two pieces come together is riding high, so I'm burnishing it to make it flatter. They both have this phenomenon. And I am beginning the process of touching up this poster. I'm using water reversible gouache to do the color matching for all those areas that I did paper fills in. Thank you.
progress is being made on these Coke posters. As you can see. The heavy artillery takes over.
Black spots?
I don't know. They're in various places in the poster. I'm not sure what to tell you because sometimes the spots are big, so I think they should be painted over. But I'm more worried about the big ones like here rather than these. But I don't know. They could be picked out, but there's so many of them in several different places. I'm thinking we should just paint over it.
Thank you.
that skin and shadow you're doing, right?
Yeah. I have to match with this color. Not that color. That color is more red.
Yeah, we'll see when it's done how it looks. Right now it looks too dark, but I suppose when it's all done it'll look better. This one has a stain in it. You see?
It's all stain.
Well, anyway, I have to match with it. It has everything.
Huh?
Letter, figure,
frame.
Yeah, frame. It has everything. Thursday I'm gonna finish everything.
Okay.
Letter, the number.
The letters, the number, the year, and the border.
Some of the
record. Right, and the border.
It's some red that need to be touched up like this.
Yeah. Good job. Another day to go and we'll be done. Finger?
What?
Finger? Thank you. Border now, I guess that means you feel like it's the last stretch. Thank you.
It's just something like that. You can do with a pencil.
Yeah.
Like there's a light highlight here. I can do a pencil yellow.
Well, we're about ready to take the tape off of this one. And my wife is still doing the last touches on this one. This is an exciting moment.
She's already done more work than is humanly necessary for this.
Do you think so?
Oh, it's beautiful. It's...
No.
Go ahead. They really look good. The poster looks so good.
Yeah, figures come out ready.
Yeah.
It's just not really. I'm just too nice.
This last one is almost finished.
touches.
Putting the finishing touches on this last Coca-Cola poster from 1936. There's no artist signature on this poster, but there is.
There's some here.
Oh, there is? Let's see. Litho in USA, 1936. Forbes, Boston. Ooh, Forbes. But there's no. What about the other side? Is there a signature here? Yeah. Copyright Coca-Cola Company. But there's no artist signature, but I suspect it could be by the same artist. There used to be an artist, I have his name written down, an artist that did the Coca-Cola Santa Claus and all the old advertisements. He's a really good illustrator. This looks like his style.
That about wraps it up for this edition of Poster Fix Studio. After 33 years of restoring vintage posters, I still look forward to seeing what you're going to send me. So keep them coming. I appreciate it. Take care.
Nice job, Okhee.
Usual.
Happy New Year.